And now I shall take you to that sweet company of Anokhe Rang. The genius maestro of Anokhe Rang is Dr. Krishan Chhabra. Recently, Dr. Chhabra met Swami Mukundananda of JKYog. We broadcasted part one of the interview last week. Please stay tuned to the second half of this dialogue.
Hello, I'm Dr. Krishan Chhabra and welcome to Anokhe Rang. Once again, I have a great pleasure and honor of having Swami Mukundananda Ji, the founder of JKYog, he's with us today. Swami Ji, namaskar. And once again, on behalf of the viewers from the Washington metropolitan area, thank you for your time and welcome to the MHZ Networks and Global Television Network Studio.
Namaste, Krishan Chhabra Ji. It is my absolute delight to be with you here in the studio. Thank you for calling me.
Thank you, Swami Ji. So today we are going to be having part two of the two-part series of the interview with Swami Ji. As you may have seen in part one that aired last month on the 1st of October, Swamiji talked about many things, including the role of spirituality, balancing materialism and spiritualism, mind management, and uniqueness of JKYog. We truly admire Swamiji's immense knowledge, deep wisdom, fascinating style of presentation, and yes, a great sense of humor. And with that, Swamiji, I would like to continue with part two of the interview.
Please do.
So, Swamiji, when anyone speaks about the Hindu philosophy, how can we know that it is authentic?
Krishan Chhabra Ji, that question is very vital because spiritual knowledge is something that people base their entire life upon. So the knowledge needs to be perfect. If the knowledge itself is defective and we create beliefs on defective knowledge, then our whole life veers in a wrong, inauspicious direction. That is why knowledge in the spiritual side needs to be validated. In our Hindu religion, which we call Sanatana Dharma, the authority is the Vedas. Bhutam bhavyam bhavishyancha sarvan vedat prasiddhyati. Any spiritual principle's authenticity is determined on the basis of the Vedas. And why is that so? Because the Vedas don't have a human origin. They are called apaurusheya. In other words, the Vedas are not the name of a book. They are the eternal knowledge of God. And when he creates the world, he manifests this knowledge. It was revealed in the heart of the firstborn Brahma. And from there, the Vedic knowledge came down by the oral tradition from guru to disciple. That is why another word for the Vedas is Shruti, or knowledge that was received through the ear. 5,000 years ago, Veda Vyas, who was an avatar of God himself, he looked into the coming age and he saw that the people of Kalyug will not be Shruti Dhari. They won't have the capacity to hear and remember. So he wrote down the Vedas and divided that body of knowledge into four parts: the Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sam Veda, Atharva Veda. He is called Veda Vyas, the divider of the Vedas, but never called Veda Rachaita. That's why even though he wrote them down, the Vedas are still aparushya, without any human origin. And the other Vedic scriptures like the Gita, the Mahabharata, the Ramayana, they are all based on the authority of the Vedas. And they all say that, look, we are referring to the Vedas. So this Vedic literature together is the authority. Now, this Vedic literature needs to be understood from a teacher or the guru because it's all divine. So that divine knowledge, we need a teacher who can explain the purport to us. But again, the question of validity comes. What is the validity of our guru? Initially, you need to verify that. you check with all the other gurus in history. Did Shankaracharya, Madhavacharya, Ramanujacharya, Vallabhacharya, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Sur, Tulsi, Meera Kabir, Nanak, Tukaram, did they all say that we are the soul, not the body? Did they all say that the world is created by God? If it is corroborated, the Shastra, the Guru and the Sadhu, now that knowledge is authentic. And once you determine the authenticity of that knowledge, then you can take the leap of surrendering to the Guru, because you know that you have got a bona fide and perfect source.
Very well explained. Very nice. Now, Swamiji, speaking about the grace of God, do you find any common thread between different scriptures as well as the religions?
Sure. The need for God's grace is very simple. Our human senses are limited, our mind is limited, our intellect is limited. And that is why we can only go this far.
Right.
God is beyond the purview of our senses, mind and intellect.
Right.
So no matter how much we keep thinking, our thoughts are unable to fathom the personality of God.
Yes.
So all the religious traditions of the world have recognized this limitation and emphasized that for success, besides self-effort, you need the grace of God. Sri Krishna has said it very clearly. Mat chittaha sarva durgani mat prasadat tarishyasi. Arjun, by my prasad or by my grace, you will cross over this ocean of life and death. Tameva sharanam gachha sarva bhavena bharata tat prasadat param shantim sthanam prapsyasi shashvatam. Shri Krishna says, Arjun, God is residing in your heart. Surrender to Him, become the benefactor of His grace, and you shall attain perfect peace. But the same is also mentioned in the other scriptures. The Bible says, for by grace you are saved through faith and not of yourself. It is a gift of God. And the Quran Sharif begins from here. The first ayat of the first chapter of the Quran says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Arrahmanir Rahim, Malik Yawmuddin. Allah Miya Khudawan Taala Rahim hai aur Kareem hai. Dayalu hai aur Kriparu hai. Or by His grace, you will be able to attain all auspiciousness. In fact, the first part of this ayat, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, this is in the beginning of each chapter of the Quran. In the Guru Granth Sahib, Guru Nanak says, Nadri karai ta ehu mohu jai, Nanak hari siu rahai samai. It is by nadri or by grace that you will be able to go over this ocean of maya. So all the religions of the world, all the saints, all the scriptures, all the different traditions have told us that look, there is this divine supreme power, you need to surrender to Him, and then by His grace you will attain the blessedness that you are seeking.
Very impressive. In other words, there is a unity among the diversity, meaning different religions, but they all have a common thread and speak of the same thing. Very,
very
interesting.
Very correct.
So, Swamiji, your book titled Spiritual Dialectics is a fascinating anthology of questions and answers. Can you tell us something about it?
Krishanji, in my travels around USA, I found that people had so many questions wherever I was going, and they did not have the access to the answers. So they are only able to meet Swamiji for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and they don't have enough time to get the answers to their questions. Now, when you have a question and it's unanswered, that becomes very troublesome.
Yes.
So your journey tends to stop. I need the answer to this, only then I can move forward. That's why I decided that what I can do is, I can gather the questions of everybody. Now, I have been disseminating this knowledge for 33 years. So, based on that experience, I know the kind of questions that come in people's minds. Before writing this book, I sent out a message through Twitter, through the Google groups, and through the emails to everybody, send your questions in. And then I gathered the common ones, the important ones, the representative ones, and divided them into different chapters. So we selected 126 of the most important and common questions.
Wow.
And put them in this book. And I tried to answer them simply and logically. So Karl Marx wrote Dialectical Materialism. Based on that, I took the cue. And I named this Spiritual Dialectics. So dialectics means questions and answers. This tradition of questions and answers is very popular in our Vedic scriptures. Many of the Upanishads are questions and answers between the guru and the disciple. In the Srimad Bhagavat Mahapuran, you've got different dialogues between Shukadev and Parikshit, between Sutaji and Shaunakadik, between Vidur and Maitreya, between Krishna and Uddhav, between Jad Bharat and Rahugan. So this system of question and answer is so popular. So I said, may as well utilize this system in presenting the knowledge to people and help them dispel their doubts.
Wonderful. Actually, the beauty of this book is, Swamiji, that you have covered a very vast, spectrum of the question, the spiritual question, going from one end to the other. Now, Swamiji, you are running the only 50-bed naturopathy hospital in eastern India. Can you tell us something about naturopathy and what this hospital has accomplished?
When my spiritual master asked me to start teaching about holistic health and well-being of individuals, so at that time I made a study and I found that people are tired of the allopathic system. You fall sick, the doctor gives you a pill, you pop the pill in. It cures the systems, but what does it do to the body? So people are more now being disgusted of that. They are looking for alternatives that tackle holistic health. And there are different systems of alternative medicine. In India, we have Ayurveda and we also have naturopathy.
Yes.
The problem in Ayurveda is that although it is a nice science, you don't get the pure medicines nowadays, the herbal medicines. And then people keep taking the medicines, they find it's not working. In some cases it does, but in many cases it doesn't. So that becomes disappointing. And that's why I turned to naturopathy. And naturopathy is not just a system of curing, it's a lifestyle, and it helps the patients bring about a lifestyle change. Naturopathy's theory is that our body has that vital force within itself, which tends to heal and cure given the right environment. So if you go to a naturopathy hospital, the doctor will help you, based on the diagnosis, do a detox. That means through all your life, all the toxins that you've been accumulating by eating wrong things and taking the wrong medicines, he will do a detox. And after that, the doctor tries to help you regenerate that force without the use of drugs. Now, in naturopathy, it's a drugless system of cure, where the five elements are used: earth, water, fire, air, sky. And with the help of diet control, with the help of massages, with the help of different exercises, cures are endeavored. So we established in East India. Now there are many naturopathy hospitals in Kerala. But in East India, where my ashram is, naturopathy was not so popular or so known. So we established this naturopathy hospital. And because it's a spiritual environment, patients who come there, they get morning, evening satsang as well. And it becomes an eye-opener to them. They say, you know, I was rejuvenated and it taught me how to lead my life henceforth so that I can live a healthy life after this.
Swamiji, looks like this is an excellent add-on to your holistic approach, meaning, and you're adding it, or I should say, as we say it in Hindi, Sone Par Sohaga, I guess. This, you know, along with the JKYog and all the principles you have, actually it makes much better in terms of the lifestyle and things like that.
That's very right, because yes. We were already teaching the holistic system of yoga, of yoga, and this fitted in so well.
Swamiji, I wonder if you would recommend people to become a sadhu and follow the path you have chosen, or how can we practice spirituality while living a household life?
There is a misnomer in our Indian spirituality.
Okay.
People think to be spiritual means to become a sadhu. So they'll land up in the last 15 minutes of my lecture, and when they hear me speaking, they say, that makes sense. So that gets them worried. If this makes sense, then do I also have to become a sadhu? But they miss the point. Our scriptures are not telling us about external change. The whole Bhagavad Gita is about internal change. Before the Bhagavad Gita, Arjun was a warrior.
Yes.
After hearing the knowledge of the Bhagavad Gita as well, he was still a warrior. He was still doing the same things that he had been doing earlier. So what changed? It was his own inner consciousness. That's the difference between religion and spirituality. Religion focuses on the externals. You must do this ritual, you must apply this tilak, you must wear this pat, you must do 7 rounds or 5 rounds. And spirituality focuses on the internal.
Right.
Like Saint Kabir said, prema bhava ik chahiye, bhes anek banaya, chahe ghar me vas kar, chahe van me jaye. What is necessary is the inner love for God. So the Bhagavad Gita, in fact, introduces us to a very powerful concept of Karm Yog. What is Karm Yog? Karm plus yog.
Yog.
You do your karm, your worldly duties, because that is your nature. Everybody has different natures. Somebody by nature is an administrator, somebody by nature is a teacher, somebody by nature is a businessman. Now you make the businessman start teaching and he will feel suffocated. So Sri Krishna recognizes that everybody has an intrinsic nature. And he says, Arjun, look, because in the beginning itself, Arjun says, I am totally confused and I will not do my duty. So Sri Krishna explains to him that the goal of life is spiritual. Arjun says, then it's doubly confirmed. If the goal of life is spiritual, then why should I do these material duties? Sri Krishna says, Arjun, look, this is your nature. By nature, you are a king. Now, artificially, you go into the jungle and become a sadhu. What will happen? The nature will not change. You will gather the bheels in the forest and become their king. Instead of that, work in accordance with your nature, but add yog to it. What is the yog? Along with work, keep your mind free of anger, greed, hatred, desire, envy. Keep your mind internally equipoised and connected to God. So if you can do your works and alongside with that, keep your mind in yoga, Such a person then is a Karma Yogi. Some people misunderstand the concept and they say, you know, Swamiji, I'm also a Karma Yogi. I say, how? You know, in the morning I get up and do half an hour of yoga, and then after that I forget about God, I close my puja room, put God in the closet, and then I start doing my karma. I'm doing karma, I'm doing yoga, so I'm a Karma Yogi. So I explain that no, the Bhagavad Gita says Karma Yog means if you can do karma and alongside me in yoga, then you'll be a Karma Yogi. Sarveshu kaleshu mahamanusmara yudhya cha. If we have to summarize the whole Gita in 1/4 of a line, it is this. Sarveshu kaleshu mahamanusmara yudhya cha. Do your duty and remember God. So Swami Vivekanand put this very nicely. He said, why was the Bhagavad Gita taught in the battlefield? Why did the Lord choose that place? He says he chose the worst situation of the material realm. It can't get worse than the battleground. And that's where he taught spiritual knowledge. Why? He wanted to convey the message that even in this situation, you can be internally in yoga. So nobody can say, you know, I'm in household life, I've got children, grandchildren, how will I engage in spirituality? Sri Krishna says, if Arjun could do it, then you can also do it through the science of Karma Yoga.
It's a very sublime and powerful message, Swamiji, the gist of Gita. Thank you. And finally, Swamiji, you come to USA for 7 months every year. What are the programs and the retreats that you conduct?
Since I started coming to USA, primarily since 2009. And initially I came for 2 months, then I increased it the next year to 4 months, and then I increased it the next year to 5.5 months. And after that, every year I've been coming here for 7 months. The reason being my spiritual master, Kripaluji Maharaj, wanted me to spread this knowledge in the Western world. So I divide my time, 7 months here and 5 months in India. Now, in those 7 months, we've kind of formed a circuit which I go through. So, okay. I visit about 20 cities and we have week-long programs in each of them. Oh. And in these week-long programs, we have 2 parts. Every day there are 2 segments. The first segment is the holistic system of yoga and meditation, called the JKYog system, or yoga for the body, mind and soul.
Yes.
Where I teach the 5 sciences of yogasana, pranayama, meditation, subtle body relaxation and healthy diet. And then in the next segment, I take a topic of spirituality or applied spirituality, how to apply spirituality in your daily life. And then I give a spiritual talk on that. So this year in many places in USA, I spoke on the topic 7 mindsets for success in life and beyond. So this is a topic of applied spirituality that people found very interesting. A few years yes. ago, I had spoken on the topic of the art of mind management. Right. And last year I was speaking in many places on how to grow from within to succeed in life. Apart from that, we also conduct retreats. So these week-long programs, they introduce people to spirituality, give them the theoretical knowledge. But then now the next step is also very necessary, and that is implementing it in our lives. So we invite them to retreats. We have about 4 retreats in the year through the 7 months. We have a retreat in the East Coast, a retreat in the West Coast, a retreat in Texas. So we have 3 to 4 retreats every year. And in the retreats, the people are there full time. So there is no disturbance of the external world. They don't need to bother about the house or the cooking or anything. The idea is to have an immersive experience. And in that immersive experience, the first day, they are trying to take the mind to God. We take them through yoga, pranayama, meditation, morning, evening lectures, chanting of bhajans, nature walks, question answers.
And also Hatha Yoga. And also always Hatha Yoga. You're a fan of Hatha Yoga.
And then second day, they find that their mind is naturally going to God, because now there are no worldly distractions. So they have a wonderful time in second night when they go to sleep. The third morning they wake up, and that is so blissful because now the mind is united with God. Invariably people come and tell me, Swamiji, these 3 days were the best days of my life. Now I understand why they had that experience, because their mind got attached to God, and because of that they got the bliss of God. That bliss of God they got was so sweet that they say, I really enjoyed these 3 days. We have quite a few retreats as well.
Swamiji, I wish we could go on. It has been really, really enlightening. But looks like we are coming to the end of part two. I would request you once again to face the camera and for about 30 seconds or so, give our viewers the final message that you would like to give.
Most of us understand and appreciate that we bring auspiciousness and blessedness in our lives by connecting with God. But how do we do it remains a question mark. And the answer is quite simple, really. Block a time in your schedule where there is no worldly distraction on a daily basis. And utilize that time to immerse the mind in God. This is the daily sadhana. Consider the example of milk and water. If you mix milk with the water, the milk gets diluted. It's unable to retain its quality because the water affects it. But if for some time you can keep the milk away from the water, and then transform it into yogurt, and then churn the yogurt and extract butter. This butter now can challenge the water. Mr. Water, I'll sit on your head and float. You can do nothing to me. Like the milk is the mind. Like the water is the world. Living in the world, despite our best intentions, we get distracted. We wish to absorb ourselves in God, and we find we are unable to do it. It seems to be so difficult. So all you need to do is that for 1 hour every day, you sit down in your puja room. Don't allow the pagers and WhatsApp and mobiles to reach you there, and absorb yourself. The Gita says, Vivikta Sevi Lagvashi. The Bible says, when thou prayest, enter thy closet and lock thy door. So that absorption in God will be so helpful that for the rest of the day, you will find even though you're doing your works, your consciousness is flying high. So please try it out and see how it helps you change your life.
Swamiji, we truly appreciate your time and sincerely thank you for your profound knowledge, wisdom, and sharing it with our viewers. On a personal note, Swamiji, it has been a great privilege for me to have had this unique opportunity to be able to interview you. And I sure have gathered some gems of wisdom, which I believe are going to make my life better as well as holistic. So, wishing you all a very happy Thanksgiving. Please join me again on the first Sunday of next month for another segment of Anokhe Rang. And finally, enjoy some short video clips providing you information about Swamiji, JK Yog, and all the special activities and the programs that they have. Namaskar.
Namaste, Kishanji, and namaste to all your viewers.
Thank you, Swamiji.
JK Yog is a worldwide non-profit organization established with the mission of helping society attain spiritual, mental, and physical well-being. JK Yog was founded by Swami Mukundananda, a world-renowned spiritual teacher and senior disciple of Jagatguru Sri Kripaluji Maharaj. JK Yog offers many life-transforming programs and initiatives for your spiritual growth and personal development. Balmukund is a specially designed personality development program for children. Our Balmukund centers fill young hearts with love for God and teach young minds lifelong lessons in Vedic wisdom and Indian values. In addition, students learn to strengthen concentration, apply creativity to problem solving, and overcome obstacles with confidence and faith. The JKYog Youth Club and Toastmasters program aims to shape our next generation of leaders by giving our youth opportunities to develop communication and leadership skills and inspiring them towards a purposeful life of service and giving back to the community. Meals, money and essentials are regularly distributed to the poor, blind and physically challenged in various parts of India. The mission is also one of the largest contributors to disaster relief all across India and Nepal. In addition to its international charity efforts, JKYog has launched several grassroots charity programs in the US to benefit our local communities. JKYog also hosts highly popular blogs and discussion forums on Vedic philosophy, inspired living and wellness for life that serve large communities of enthusiasts and seekers. And the JKYog YouTube and radio channels bring you ever new spiritual content and devotional bliss on the go.